did we go though?
I do now.
Okay. Alhamdulillah. So you on a journey. So you believe in God, but you don't believe that you don't have a religion, basically.
No, I don't. I denounced my faith when I was 17. I went to a Catholic school. I was brought up as a Catholic.
Yeah.
And then I denounced my faith when I was around 17.
You denounced what? Christianity.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because at that point, I thought there was no point believing in something which it didn't make sense.
That's true. Because it doesn't go in line, yeah.
Plus, because it didn't make sense and I didn't have no explanations. And at that time, especially with our generation,
yeah,
the generation now and just behind me, yeah, they were able to speak their mind and so forth, whatever. Okay. Teachers wouldn't get into trouble, like, yeah, when we were in school and so, okay, forth. They'd say, no, you need to go out. And now, many times, yeah, I got kicked out of the classroom because I said, well, the way you're portraying Jesus is schizophrenic.
So that's true, bipolar.
So I got kicked out of the classroom for that.
Okay.
And I wasn't allowed to take my exam.
Okay, because, were you going to a Catholic school or?
I went to a Catholic school.
Okay, that's why.
Because I didn't believe in the Trinity,
yeah,
it didn't make sense.
Yeah.
I wasn't allowed to take it.
Okay,
so I was classed as a hypocrite. I was classed as this, I was classed as
that. Because you're asking a question.
You're asking questions.
Ask a question.
Yeah.
The teachers couldn't get away with that now. They would have to answer that.
Yeah.
They'd have to answer that.
Yeah, now, of course. Okay, of course.
But
before,
then,
yeah.
No way.
Yeah. How long ago?
I'm 47 now. So
37?
47.
You're 47?
Yeah. So
after we have to write down, we have to give us advice, bro. We're gonna give you spiritual food, you give us physical food. Alright, we have to exchange here.
You're gonna ask him which passport now. Yeah.
That's how it is.
You're I think 29, 32. How old are you, bro?
Shamsi, you're my brother.
How old are you?
We stay mates.
47. Bro, where are you coming from? Is it that nigga? Is it that? Is your son?
That's his son there.
MashaAllah, man. MashaAllah. That's good, man. Look after yourself, man. Yeah. That's good. Trust me, man. Some people, brother, are 19. You think he's 65.
Yeah.
No, he's 19 years old. You look 65, bro.
I've seen a few.
You know what I'm saying? It's good to take care of yourself, yeah? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely.
That's what I'm speaking. He's telling me back then, they were able to do it. But now, where did you guys tell me back then?
How far back?
Is it early 2000, 1997?
Yeah.
Respect that, man.
Long time ago.
That's good. Yeah, so they were able to do that.
They were able to,
to stop you from exam.
Yeah. But then, yeah, kicked out of the classroom, you can't do this and you can't believe that.
Okay.
And why can't I believe that? It doesn't make sense. I just want the truth. I don't mean
to disrespect, yeah.
I just want to know the truth.
Question, yeah. That's so, why, you know, people always ask, there's too many religions out there. How can we differentiate which one is the truth? Okay? What we know that the most wise, the most high, will not create us without giving us a clear distinction between the truth and the falsehood. And that's why the Creator gave us what? Tools within us that we are able to utilize, regardless of our background, Christianity, Judaism, Hinduism. You have those tools, which is the natural inclinations and the sound reasoning and the perceptions, you know? For example, when you say, for example, let's talk about Christianity, because when I was speaking to yesterday, I was outside Shevibu Station giving da'wah, you know, preaching. And the guy, he was around, this young boy, a Christian, he was around 16, 17. And I said, he said, I'm not a Christian scholar, so I cannot answer you. I said, look, what I'm talking about here, you don't have to be a Christian scholar. What you have to have, just you have to have a brain. If Jesus is God, and God is the most high, and God knows everything all the time, by definition, if Jesus is God, he must be the all-knowing. You cannot tell me God knows everything all the time. At the same time, Jesus is God, but he doesn't know the hour. That doesn't make any sense. You don't have to have a PhD from Oxford University or Harvard University to understand that doesn't make any sense. You know what I'm saying, bro? Likewise, you don't have to have qualification from any college or university to know the most high doesn't become a baby someone changes nappy. Doesn't make any sense, bro. You understand? Like, you know, anyone can step back, think, oh, you know what? God gave me intellect. That's why in the Quran, Allah always say, don't you reflect? Don't you use your brain? Don't you use your intellect? because it's a blessing, the intellect, you know? So utilize it. That's what Allah always, in the Quran I'm talking about, yeah? When Allah wants to establish His Lordship, that He's a true Lord, He's the Creator, He's the Most High. What it does, Allah uses the intellectual facts. For example, Allah said, I will recite in Arabic, then translate the meaning. Allah said, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتِ الْأُولِ الْأَلْبَابِ. Within the creations of the heavens and the earth, and the changing, the alteration of day and night, it is a science for people understanding. It's true, when you reflect upon the creation, everything is connected. You know what I'm saying? Like just reflect upon our own creation. I always mention this example, brother, that we have a nose next to our mouth. Why? Before you eat, smell food. Imagine your nose is next to your toe. Bro, there's a big problem, man. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? You don't want to leave, man. You want to kill yourself. You know what I'm saying? So, you have eyebrows above our eyes. Why? Because the sweat contains the salt. And if it keeps going to your eye, it will damage it. So, it'll protect it. We have a joint in our elbows to utilize them. We have eyes front of our front, not the back, because we walk forward. You know? So, everything, even the liquid that we have in our eyes is completely different than the liquid that we have in our ears. The one our ears is special for the ears to protect us from, you know, the flies going in, and other than that, you know. Likewise, the liquid and the water we have in our eyes is special. So you're telling me us came by chance, all of this programmed and connected and organized? That's what Allah said, use your brain. Don't let the people try to control your observation of this creation. Tremendous, beautiful creation. You see what I'm saying, brother? So when we come to that, we know the most wise creator will not create the creation without a purpose. Do you agree with that? Every part of our body has a purpose, you know? So therefore, logic dictates the one who knows our purpose for this life is the one who made us. For example, if I made a phone and I'm the first person to make a phone, no one knows about the phone better than I, because I made it from scratch. So if anyone wants to learn about the phone in detail and understand the purpose behind this phone, it has to come to me. It's a logical argument, rational argument. Now, as Muslims, we say another logical argument to prove that how the Creator told us about how our purpose of this life by choosing people from our type, not from different creation, to communicate with us, to tell us about our purpose of this life. But again, some people, they're going to claim to be the messenger of the Most High, but they are the biggest liars. So now, how can we differentiate between a true chosen messenger of the Creator and between a liar? There is what criteria? I will mention it to you, brother. What's your name? So I ask your name.
Colossus.
My name is Shamsi. Okay, brother. So I will mention to you Colossus, yeah, and analyze. One of the characteristics, this messenger of the Creator should be known to be trustworthy, truthful, honest. Why? Because if he's a liar, then we have an excuse to reject him. Because you say, hold a minute, you're known to be a liar. Now you're claiming to be the messenger of the Most High, the one who created this tremendous creation. Nah. But if you know him to be trustworthy, truthful, honest, okay, let me listen more. Second one, they come with the same teachings. Jesus, Moses, Abraham, Noah, Jacob, Jeremiah, Daniel, Isaac, all the prophets and messengers of God. There were many of them, okay? Even though they never met each other while they were preaching upon the earth, they came with the same teaching. What is the teachings? Worship one God, appreciate and show gratitude to your Creator according to His will. Okay? That's the foundation. And believe in that there is a death and there's a life after death, and you'll be accounted according, you'll be judged according to your actions, good or bad. Okay? This is the foundation. However, they come with different legislation here and there. All right, brother? Now, that's the second one. They come with the same teaching. Third one, they come with the prophecies, prophesizing about the future. For example, because logic dictates, the one who knows about this creation in detail is the one who made it. You agree with that? Okay. Now, I don't have to speak about Jesus, Moses, you know these names already, yeah? What I would do, if I establish Prophet Muhammad to be true prophet with a logical argument, with the tangible proofs, then the logic dictates, we should believe what he came with. Why? Because we know the Most High will not choose a liar to convey his message. Make sense? All right. Now, Prophet Muhammad, he was known to be a truthful and honest person amongst his nations. Even there is historians, non-Muslims, there's I don't want to speak to you. Yeah, okay. There's historians from the non-Muslims that mention about Prophet Muhammad that this man, if he was be called, he would be called the savior of humanity. Okay? He was known to be trustworthy. I don't want to speak to you. I spoke to you many times. You can watch the video. I'm speaking to this guy. You know, that's Christianity to show respect.
Anyway.
Okay. I don't want to speak to you. That's it. You know, I can't. Anyway. Okay. The Christian is going to listen. Anyway. The point here is, he's known to be trustworthy, honest, and truthful person. Okay? Secondly, the prophecies that he came with. What is the prophecies? Prophet Muhammad said, bear in mind, he lived where? 1,400 years ago. Leave. She's known. Brother can later watch the video. For Hatun. Yeah, alhamdulillah, you've seen. Alhamdulillah. You know, khalas. As Prophet Muhammad said, al-khabar laysa kal-mu'ayana. Information, not like when you see it. Alhamdulillah. So the point here, Prophet Muhammad said, it will come a time when a person will make up a lie. By the morning, his lies will reach far east, far west. This narration, Sahih Bukhari, one of the most authentic book after the Quran, yeah? What we have to understand, bro, Prophet Muhammad said that in a time, in order for you or I to travel from London to Cardiff, will take me 3 days. Took 3 days. And now, let alone for your lie to spread far east, far west, okay? Now, what you do, make up a lie, put it in Instagram, Snapchat. You okay?
This is the name.
Oh, okay, thank you. Snapchat, you can take one.
Yeah. Are you Muslim, yeah?
Yeah. So you can make up a lie. And your lie, by the morning, will reach far east, far west. The question we ask ourselves, how men that lived 1,400 years ago knew about something, not randomly, detailed, specific.
Like what? Like the fact when Muhammad said the sun set where the...
Excuse me, can you respect? You came as a respectful person. Now you're swearing.
So it's,
okay, speakers corner. So you're happy for swearing?
People can join.
So act civil.
What about
I'm speaking to him. Okay. Is that a human being or not? No, I'm saying.
Yeah.
Anyway, the point here is that how men lived 1,400 years ago. Yeah, but you come in and you're just disturbing us. I know you have a lot of questions. I have no problem to answer every question you're going to ask, as long as you be respectful. All right?
Your freedom is finished when the other guy freedom starts. So you need
halas. Anyway, bro, welcome to Speaker's Corner, man. it's like jungle here. You know what I'm saying? You know, some people think if I'm inside Speaker's Corner, I have to become a donkey. No, you're still a human being. Inside Speaker's Corner, outside Speaker's Corner. Okay? Doesn't mean Speaker's Corner, you have to become a donkey. All right? Anyway, the point here is, another one. Prophet Muhammad said, it will come a time when the Arabs, they will stop using the camels as a riding beast. What we have to understand, if the Arabs, they don't use camels as a riding beast, what are they going to use, especially in the desert? But Prophet Muhammad, ﷺ, doesn't stop there. He said, it will come a time when they will be using something as a box, okay, that will take them from their houses with their wives to the mosque. Now we go Qatar, Saudi, Dubai, Gulf countries. They don't use camels anymore. Why they use cars? So how men again live in 1,000 Ferraris, you know what I'm saying? Ferraris, not any car, bro. 1,400 years ago, knew about something like that. Likewise, brother, there's many prophecies I will mention. One of them, I'll give you another one. Prophet Muhammad mentions about the Arab Peninsula. He said the Arab Peninsula was full of gardens and rivers, and it would turn into that again. Now, as one of the Islamic scholars, Imam Albani, he said, you know, you can see now, Dubai 50 years ago was a pure desert. You go to Dubai, you think, what? How this can exist in a desert? Thanks gardens, water,
even
you know what I'm saying?
Huh?
Yeah. Okay, yes. Brother, can you take out that speaker? Or take him, I don't know if it's him or her. I'm not sure. Is it him or her? I don't know, but anyway, brother. What I would say to you, brother, so I'll give you another one, bro, yeah? The Prophet Muhammad also, in the Quran, he mentions that this religion, Islam, will prevail all other religions. Akhi, please, take her. Please, you can't have two conversations.
I can be wherever I want.
Okay. Akhi, don't speak. Akhi, please. Please, barakallahu. Yeah, here is the Middle East, yeah.
No, it's not.
Yeah, we got to change it to Middle East. Okay. Anyway, it's the Middle East of Speaker's Corner. Okay. Anyway, the point, Allah mentioned the Quran. Allah mentioned in the Quran that this religion will overpower the other religions. Even if the Islamic haters dislike it. Now we know there is many barriers against Islam. There is a dirty, disgusting war against Islam. There is no country has been invaded except the Muslim countries. Why? For a lies and because they're not happy with our religion. You know? So now, even there, and also from ISIS, who give him bad image about Islam, you know? Likewise, they are evil people. Now, we know the fastest growing religion on the face of the earth in the Western world. We're not using spoon. We're not using a fork. We're not using a sword. We're not using nothing. Woman, man, accepting Islam in Britain. In Britain, your wife can call police and they'll put you in prison so quick. Let alone you forcing someone else to become Muslim. But why they accepted Islam? Because they noticed that the true freedom and Islam goes in line with the natural inclination and the sound reasoning. You know? So again, how men that lived 1,400 years ago prophesizing that, and he's put in a condition. He said, even if the Islamic haters dislike it, that this religion will overpower the other religions. You know? Another one, the Quran.
Slavery,
The Quran.
What about slavery?
I'll talk about this one. I'll come, don't worry. Okay. Eh? Women, we love women. That's why we get married to four. You know? Alhamdulillah, we love them. If we hate women, what are we going to marry to four? You know what I'm saying?
Can you talk about how Muhammad called Ethiopia's culture racist?
I thought he's talking.
Explain why is that.
Okay, why, before we explain why there's a full woman, let us stick with the foundation that I explain. No problem with a full woman. Now, firstly, that what I said, does it make sense?
Yeah,
is it clear? What we say to you, look, brother, yeah? Can we move, if you don't mind? Color is moved, yeah. Okay, come.
Sorry, my
love. Brother, even these guys don't know you for the 1920. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, because to get the brother, I'm not a she, who, he, I don't know who is she. I'm confused what I'm going to call. Tell her I have a wife, man. I'm not interested, man. Okay, just leave the brother to have this conversation. So before we go, it's a good question. The brother asked about why we're allowed to have four wives. Before we come to that, the point here, that if it makes sense to you, so what is the two pillars of Islam, which is the Shahadatan, the foundation of Islam, what is it? The first one, that I bear witness, there's no one worthy of worship except Allah, okay? And I bear witness Muhammad, the messenger of Allah. I'm going to explain this to you logically. You know, I always mention example, brother, I think you heard me online, I mentioned it, that if I give you £2 million as a gift, what would you say to me at least? Thank you, bro, £2 million, you know what I'm saying? You're going to buy a nice house, nice car, big money. And now I will give you £2 million, and before that, of course, you're going to remember me all the time. £2 million. Now, if I give you £2 million on a condition, I will give you £2 million, but on a condition, give me your two eyes. Would you do that?
No.
No, go. Why? Because your eyes is more valuable than £2 million. So why we are not grateful to the one who gave us our eyes for free? You see what I'm saying? Now, brother, if you are in a house and there is a fire, you are surrounded by a fire, you are about to die. For a fact, you're about to die. So what I do, I come and save your life. So what would you say? What would you say? Okay, I will talk about it. Okay, I will talk about it. Just calm down. I will come and save your life. You're about to die, bro. They was like about to finish. What would you say to me? Thank you. You're gonna remember me. I saved your life, bro. You're gonna be very grateful to me. You're gonna remember Shamsi all the time for saving your life. Now, what about the one who gave us a life for free? Why we are not grateful to him? Why we are not thankful to him? That is the first part. We should worship him. That's what Allah said in the Quran. If you try to count Allah's blessings on you, you will never be able to do so.
What
you understand?
Surah 929.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think he's been brainwashed and he comes here too.
I'm
a feet wash. I'm feet wash, not brain.
I thought you had free speech.
Yeah.
Brainwashing.
Yeah. Khalas.
Thank you. Go back to your.
But this man, the big man, who said brainwash. Joke. No, please. So the point here is that's the first pillar. The second pillar, which is what? If you want to buy a gift for your mother, would you buy a gift that your love or your mother love? Your mother love. That's why if you want to worship the Creator, we should worship him the way he loves, not the way we love. The way he loves is objective. The way we love is subjective. That's why, based upon the Creator's wisdom and justice and mercy, he sent the messenger and the prophet to teach us about our purpose of this life. That one day you and I and all of us here, we're going to die and we'll be inside the graves by ourselves. Allah said in the Quran, لَقَدْ جِئْتُمُونَ فُرَادَ كَمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةً. You have... Brothers, if you can take her, speak to her, even take her outside. Take her or him, I don't know which one. Anyway, the point here that we should be, there's nothing guaranteed in this life, brother. And you are older than me, more wiser than me, understand? Except death. So we should utilize our time and understand our purpose. And we if the truth is clear to us, we should not hesitate to accept the truth. Understand? I was mentioning this about racism. What I was going to mention to you, brother, you know, also one of the miracles of the Quran. Quran is a miracle. One of the miracles of the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa taala mentioned the Quran. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّنَّا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُذَكِّرٍ. We have made Quran easy to be memorized. Easy to be memorized. Okay. I don't know. Do you know who has Quran here? Anyway, have you seen the Quran, the holy book of the Muslims? Let me ask a question. Do you know any book? Yeah. Let me show him the size. I want to ask a question to show like a practically the question I want to ask. Okay. This is the English one. But anyway, do you know any book like that? Okay, size of this. It's been memorized by 100 million of people. Word for word, letter for letter. You know any book? Except the Quran. This book, why this book, the only book that people memorize it, children, old, women, people who memorize the Quran, some of them don't even speak the Arabic language. Rather, when they speak the Arabic language, they will make mistakes in pronunciation, in the grammar. But when they read the Quran, they read it perfectly. Okay, they read it perfectly. And what Allah said that 1,400 years ago. Allah made this book easy to be memorized. And the way the Quran was passed down to us, generation after generation, word for word, letter for letter.
What about the rather, that Aisha said the sheep ate? Aisha said the parts of the Quran written by a sheep.
That's not true. Answer you, it's not true.
Aisha said
it's not true. It's not
true. It's in the hadith.
It's not true. Khalas, I answered you now. Can I speak to him? Can you respect him? Yeah, khalas. So don't interrupt. So the point here is that if the Jewish people, any Hinduism, Sikhism, Buddhism, you name them, if we decide, say, you know what, let us, all of us, through our scriptures, don't leave nothing written in a written form, let us throw it in the sea. The only book that will remain with us is the Quran. The Quran, because the Torah, no one memorized it. You know, no one memorized the Torah.
That's his cross. Okay. That's his cross. That's his cross.
You talk about, can you respect him or not?
But you're lying.
Okay, is it freedom? Can I lie?
No, you can't.
What about my freedom?
So there's no freedom of speech. So
you don't believe in freedom of speech?
I do, but not in freedom of lying.
Oh, you hold a minute. So there's no freedom of speech then?
Exactly. Yeah, but I'm not freedom of speech.
So you're selective.
Can you just let him talk to the man and talk to him after?
No.
Let him talk. Have some respect.
Talk to him about slavery, how Ethiopia, Mohammed called the Ethiopians raising.
He'll come back.
Have the conversation, yeah?
Abbot, right. What does it mean? Black and slave.
Hold on.
I know too much. The tricks won't work.
Right, you can have that conversation.
You can force him, but not me.
Anyway, so what I'm saying, brother, that look, the only book that remains with us is the Quran. And that's why the way the Quran, Allah preserved the Quran in a perfect way. Likewise, Allah mentioned the Quran.
Kirat will lost.
Okay. Anyway, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyway, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that the people of the book, they have changed the scriptures.
The
people of the book, Muhammad, they have changed the scriptures. Okay.
Now,
Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, he lived in Mecca 1400 years ago. Mecca was a pure desert. He didn't have the access to many manuscripts.
He was a Kaaba trainer.
To analyze the manuscript of the Nazarenes, the manuscript of the Abanites, all of this.
He was okay. A caravan trainer.
All of this, yeah. Now the Christian scholars, they will tell you the Bible has been changed over and over again.
Bible now, how
Prophet Muhammad, do you respect black man?
Of course.
course. So why are you interrupting?
I'm interrupting you because you're lying.
No, but I'm speaking to him.
That's his course.
You don't respect him.
Kira.
You don't respect him, that's why.
Aisha, what's his
name? Hold on, hold on,
part of the Quran was eaten by a sheep.
By a sheep.
Hold on, hold on. Why are you getting hold on, hold on. I'm having a conversation, that's all.
But no, you only listen to him.
No, I'm listening, but
you're not answering at all.
That's what you do in a conversation.
You say Bible. Do you believe Bible has been changed?
Hold on, he's talking. So I'm listening.
Yeah, it's a monologue.
No,
it's not dialogue.
No, 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 no.
It's a monologue.
It's not your business. He's listening, right?
All right?
But you make a bad decision.
But you're the one who's interrupting.
How do you know?
Because he's lying.
But you're the one who's interrupting.
How do you know he's lying?
I can make that decision.
You say the arguments that I cannot
convince. But I can make that decision for myself, whether I feel he's lying or not. I understand that.
If someone's lying, I would step in. If someone is lying,
I'm lying. And you've interrupted.
I had it. You've
interrupted.
If he didn't lie, I would.
Should we go outside?
That's my conversation.
We'll go outside. Shut the brother. It's entertainment.
I don't have technology yet. He's talking
first. I do, so I can talk him out.
But I can talk afterwards.
But you haven't.
I can talk. But
you haven't.
It's not up to you. It's not up to you. I can talk afterwards. I'm having a
she wanted to dictate.
Hold on. Like I was saying, he was talking to me. I'm listening, okay? I'm giving him that respect to explain what he's explaining. Hold on. But you're doing exactly what you're doing. You're not giving anyone a chance to. So I'm talking.
Hold on.
He's talking. It doesn't matter whether he's lying or not. It doesn't matter right now because I'm listening. But to you, but he's not having a conversation.
I would be killing him
later.
Tell
me to
shut up. But what's the point of listening to lies? A monologue of lies.
I will decide whether or not.
But you don't have.
I will decide whether or not if he is telling me a lie.
But you haven't called him out on anything yet.
It doesn't matter yet.
It does.
Because he's talking. While he's talking, I'm not going to say that's up to me.
So you would just let someone lie until like 24 hours?
That's up to me. If I start talking to you about anything that's happening in my life or anything like that.
Yes,
it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter right now.
Wrong.
Yeah, I do agree with that. But at the time, he is talking it. If I disagree with something, after he has said what he said,
you
I
haven't
can, I can
anything,
push it.
But
I have a way of dealing with
this
things.
This discussion is just a bit silly in the sense that he's talking.
Move on, okay, there's no point there. Okay, come. The brother himself is saying, listen. Bro, okay, forgive me, man. Thank you, brother, man. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, she's claiming, you know, what you say is a clear contradiction as well, you're showing her. You know why? Because she's dictating to you what you should say. So she's, you know what I'm saying? Okay, are you going to follow us again? Yeah, please, okay. Brothers, come this side, okay, please, allow this. Alhamdulillah, man. Anyway, my point here is that I'll finish with this. What I was saying that it's not the Muslims speaking about it now. Even the scholars in Christianity would say, look, there's many Bibles has been changed that the story about adultery, when Jesus said, the one who never sinned, let him throw the first stone. Christian scholars will tell you, Bart Ehrman, I will mention their names. One of them is Bart Ehrman is known. Say this story is not there in the earliest manuscript. My point here is, how man that lived 1,400 years ago, he knew prophecies, the miracles, all of that. How? Because we know it's from the Most High. Understand? So I always ask people, does it make sense? Is it clear to you? Now, if you have any question, you ask about the four wives.
Oh, yeah, I do.
Okay, the four wives. Now, look, there's two ways to respond to that. There's general response and detailed response. The general response will be, okay, as a Muslim, I believe God is the Most High, the all-knowing, the most wise. The one who created his creation, he knows about his creation better than anyone else. So he gave us that law for the man to marry more than one wife, okay? As long as does not oppress none of them, okay?
Where does that say that it does that?
In the Quran, yeah, of course. Quran. In the Quran, he said, yeah. Okay. He said, if you fear you cannot be just, then do not. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if a person has two wives and he favored one over the other one, then on the day of resurrection, he will become like half paralyzed. He says, dog or rat? What's going on with these dogs these days? They get smaller and smaller. They get smaller and smaller dogs these days. Anyway, Prophet Muhammad said, he will come half paralyzed, okay? Now, let us speak historically. Historically known amongst nations, amongst, you know this, now us looking as having more than one wife as a problem, this started by the Europeans when they invaded our countries. If you look to back in Africa, before the Europeans come to our countries, it was our custom to marry more than one wife. Not just in Africa, even in the time of the Romans. There many nations, many civilization was known. That's why from the human nature. Because God created with that. Likewise, women, men are known to die in the war. So there's more women than a man, you know? Like in America, if every man get married to every woman, thousands of women will be left out. We Muslims, you are here, show them love. You know, we'll get married tomorrow, alhamdulillah. But America, they have no solution for them, you understand? So that's one of the reasons. Of course, the absolute wisdom is belong to Allah. But we say, we establish that Allah is the most high, the most wise. Like, for example, I don't believe Islam is the truth because Islam allows me, with the condition to be just with my wives, to marry four wives. So therefore, Islam is the truth. No, I believe Islam is the truth because, as I mentioned, God gave us the faculties, the tools to determine what is a truth, what is a falsehood. When you look at Islamic teaching, the foundation, it goes in line with our natural inclination and our sound reasoning. Islam worship one God. Who is this God? Let us hear what Allah said about himself. Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Allah is the only one. Allahu samad. Master, self-sufficient. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begat not. Neither was he begotten. And everyone's in need of him. He's not in need of no one. And there's nothing lack unto him. That's the God I worship. I don't worship God that became baby, someone church is nappy. No, I don't worship that. I'm not trying to disrespect, but that's what they believe. Or I worship a God become an elephant. No, I don't. No, no. I believe God, when I look to God's description of the Quran, is a God that is a perfect God. Like, for example, another description of Allah, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum. Allah is the one who's the one that no one has a right to be worshipped except him. Okay, except him, all right? And he's al-hayy al-qayyum, the ever-living, and everyone is in need of him. You know what I'm saying? Likewise, what the Prophet Muhammad came teach. I want to show you this, yeah? What Islam based upon? Islam came to preserve five necessities. First one, religion. Islam came to teach the people, look, God created you. God provides for you. God provides for your parents. God provides everything for you. So you should be grateful to him. You should be thankful to him. God tell you, look, stay away from worshiping any idols, worshiping anything beside your creator. So protect you from worshiping any idols. That's the first one, protect the religion. Secondly, Islam came to protect life. That's why in Islam, if someone kills someone, we don't put him in a holiday inn, what hotel. You know, we don't put him in a hotel. So Islam, we put... Okay, all right. What about the Iraqis that died? Do you care about them? Huh? By the British and American. Look, silence.
Yeah.
Everyone make mistakes. Everyone. Millions of people died in Iraq. Mistake. Yeah. Anyway, the point here is life. Anyway, life, yeah? Islam, life is sacred. Muslim or non-Muslims, you're not allowed to kill anyone unjustly. Let me just speak. Life is sacred. Anyone that kills another person unjustly, then Islam, there's severe punishment. Thirdly, state of mind. Islam came to preserve intellect. That's why Islam, anything that harms the intellect is forbidden. Alcohol is forbidden. Drugs is forbidden. Why? Because the intellect is one. She's gonna start fighting. She's gonna start fighting this guy. You know? So Islam came to preserve state of mind, the intellect. So anything that harms the intellect.
Talk about Khaybar. Talk about what happened.
She's gonna fight him.
What's Haibar?
I don't know where's Haibar. I don't know where's Haibar. Anyway, so Islam came to preserve intellect. Now wealth. Islam preserve wealth. That's why Islam is not allowed to utilize your wealth in a haram way, meaning gambling. How many people died because of gambling? How many people left their house? They lost their houses. They lost their wealth because of gambling. You know what I'm saying? So now, dignity. In Islam, dignity is sacred. What does it mean, dignity? You're not allowed to go around accuse someone of being thief or robber without clear-cut proofs. Likewise, in Islam, if you accuse a woman to be a fornicator or a man, for example, you see a woman says, you know this woman? She's a fornicator. That's her honor. No, brother. That's her honor. So in Islam, you have to be four witnesses. What? They saw the same thing. Because the honor of the people is very important. So Islam came to preserve five things, which in the West, because we're not preserving them, is causing destruction in the universe, in the West. You see how clear? You see what I'm saying, brother? Do you have any question for me? Ask any question. Water, brothers, do you have any water? Any water, brothers? Do you want water?
No, I'm good.
How do you
know?
Go ahead, Baba. Yeah.
the reason, because you mentioned it about the wives and so forth, that's why I wanted to tell you to clarify.
Yeah.
What is it that clarifies why you can have it? You're saying it's in the Quran.
In the Quran, yeah.
And but what justifies you having that? I mean, what was it? Okay, so
for example, because a man he has desires. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And as I mentioned, historically, it's known from the human nature, man wants more than one woman. Okay, not everyone, but I'm talking. Islam came to not for individual person as a holistic. Okay, for example, Islam tell man stronger than woman. Generally speaking, even sometimes you find some woman here and there, but the law doesn't apply to just for one person. Apply it as a whole. You know. So the point here is, generally speaking, we know man wants more than one woman. That's why now look, you can even in the Western world, how many stories of men cheating on their wives? Because naturally they want more than one woman. Even in the Western world, when a man has more than one woman, they look up to him. When a woman has more than man, they look down on her. You see what I'm saying? Respectful. So Islam comes, okay, Allah created you and Allah knows that you have desires and you want more than one woman. Okay? However, don't use a woman as a game. You have as girlfriends, 10 of them. No, Allah give you a law, have 4. But if you cannot be just with them and you can control your desires, then have one wife. You see what I'm saying? So because of the man, known historically speaking, based upon the man nature, man wants more than one wife, you know? So Islam comes and says, okay, you're allowed to do that.
But women can't accept that. If so, say for instance...
I'm getting married to a woman.
But your wife... Your wife of now doesn't accept that.
Don't say that for me. Don't say it, brother. You're going to put me in trouble, brother. She's going to change her mind. I'm joking. Yeah. So Muslims speak about it. Now imagine I'm going to get married to a sister now. Okay? I'm going to marry a sister. So she said, look, marry me, but on the condition you have no wife other than me. If I sign the paper, I have to accept it.
Okay.
Yeah, this is her right. You see, so because it's her right, the scholars mentioned, you have to abide by it.
And you can't go against that.
You know, you can't. Because what Allah said in the Quran, Ufu bil uhud, fulfill the contract.
Okay.
Yeah, but now, the problem you.
Yeah.
The old Muslim woman is going to say, ask for treating skin. You friend for your child. You have to cut off. Yeah. So Allah, look, what Allah showed us here, Islam is a religion of... is a real religion, deals with the real issues. Because everyone says, you know, why you want to have one woman, or why you have to go to war? That's in a theory. But let us be realistic with ourselves. How men think, how men feel. Allah created that feeling. That's what Allah said, okay, you have that feeling, God gave it to you, generally speaking, not every person maybe, okay? However, there's a right you have to fulfill before having more than one wife. Okay, that's alhamdulillah, you know. But what I said to you, the principle and the foundation, is it clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Does it make sense to you?
It makes sense. It's something that I am actually looking more into. Hence why I've got the books and
okay.
So
what I will ask you, brother, look, I'll ask you this question as a big man, respectful man. What is stopping you to accept the truth if it's clear to you?
I'm still researching.
Researching, okay. That's good to research without any doubt, but there's difference between foundation. That's why I do, brother. When I speak to non-Muslims, I always explain the foundation. What do I mean by that? For example, now, if I establish brother here as a doctor, may Allah forbid, imagine you have a disease, and he's an expert, okay? He knows about your disease. Now, you're gonna accept his advice, correct? Even though you don't know his shoe size, even though you don't know how many wives he has, even though you don't know how much money he gets. But because why? The foundation is clear. That's why in Islam, if the foundation is clear, then it makes sense. If the foundation is clear, I accept it. Because if whatever you're going to learn after is called the branches. Because the foundation of Islam, what is it? The 5 pillars. Firstly, worship God sincerely, according to his will. That's why as a Muslim, I believe if I was alive at the time of Jesus, if I want to worship God correctly, it's by following Jesus' teaching. Because he was the way to God. Before Jesus was Moses. Now, if I want to worship God correctly, I have to follow Moses' teaching. And now the last prophet is Muhammad. To worship God correctly according to his will, I have to follow the teaching of Prophet Muhammad. That's the first pillar of Islam. Second pillar is a prayer.
The teaching of the prophet is that more explained in the hadith.
Say again?
is the hadith explain more of what
Prophet Muhammad. Yeah, Prophet Muhammad teaching the explanation of Islam more in hadith. Okay. The Quran, for example, the Quran says pray, but it doesn't go in detail. But it's Prophet Muhammad explains it in detail. Because Allah said in the Quran, oh, who you believe, obey Allah. We are alive now. How can we obey Allah? Allah doesn't speak to me. Meaning the Quran. Okay? Obey the messenger. The messenger is not alive. How can I obey him? By following his teaching. Yeah. So the hadith explains more. So for example, the prayer. The second pillar. The third pillar, charity. And the prayer. Let's talk about the prayer. Prayer is beneficial for human being, physically and spiritually. You know? When you just washing your hand, making ablution, not ablution, the wudu, washing yourself and praying to your creator, when you make prostration, you feel the burden being dropped from your back. It's beneficial for yourself, okay? So likewise, charity. How many of us will complain about poverty? But the solution is in Islam. If every rich man give 2.5 from their wealth to the poor people, then we'll be having what? No problem. So the solution is in Islam. Likewise, what? Fasting. Fasting is known. It's good for you physically. Even spiritually, it's good for you, you know? Even now, there was a study that was done by one of the British doctors. They're saying that it's highly recommended to fast even 2 days a week. But now, Prophet Muhammad said that, but they never specified, of course. They said just 2 days a week. Prophet Muhammad said, he said, fast Monday and Thursday. You see what I'm saying? So when you look to the teaching of Islam, Hajj, you see what I'm saying? Hajj is what? Good for you physically, spiritually, okay? Yeah, you know Hajj, pilgrimage to Mecca, yeah, pilgrimage to Mecca. Now the point here, when you look at the five pillars of Islam that God has legislated for us, it's not because for his own good, it's for our own good. That's what Allah said, if you worship Allah, it's for your own good. If all mankind and the jinn, you know the jinn? Jinn is like demon, yeah. The jinn kind come together and just believe in Allah, will not harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will not even harm the earth or the heaven. You understand? So whatever Allah legislates for us is good for us, brother. The pillars of Iman, to believe in Allah, to believe in the angels, Gabriel, you know, to believe in the books that God gave books to his messengers in order to guide mankind. To believe in all messengers, Moses, Abraham, all of them, okay? You believe in the last day that when you die, God will bring you back to life to judge you according to action. And you believe everything that takes place by God's permission. This is the foundation of Islam. Okay, and there's Ihsan. Ihsan, what is Ihsan? The third level of Islam, or the third level of religion, to worship God as you see him. Even though you do not see him, he surely sees you. This Islam. Islam benefits you in this life and the hereafter. And you know, that's I always mention this, no one guarantees to live tomorrow. That's why I always advise brothers, if it's clear to you, makes sense to you, accept the truth. Because when we die, no one will come with us inside the grave. And the grave is a powerful thing. That's why Allah challenged the people. Allah said, قُلْ إِنَّ الْمَوْتَ الَّذِي تَفِرُّونَ مِنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ ثُمَّ تُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ عَالِمِ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ Allah says, say to them, oh Muhammad, say to those who reject me, or turn away from me, the death that you try to run away from surely will meet you, and you will return to your Lord, and he will inform you of that which you used to do. You know what I'm saying? Like I always mention this example, brother. Imagine you sleep tonight in your own room. While you're sleeping, someone comes and picks you up, and you don't even realize. Takes you to a mountain and puts you inside the cave. When you wake up, how are you going to feel? You're going to feel mad, you know? The last thing I remember, I was in my own room in London or Birmingham. Now I'm in the cave. Maybe you lose it. The life, you're on a life. I mean, your life, drop dead. Next life. Next life, we haven't seen it. It's going to be completely bad. Allah gave the information about the next life to his prophet and his messengers. That when a person dies, three things follow him to his grave. They go with him to the graveyard. Three things. His wealth, his children, and his actions, good or bad. Two things will return. One thing will stay with you, is your actions. If it was good, it will be good for you. If it's bad, and the biggest crime against God, when you turn away from him. That's what I always mention, bro. If it's clear and makes sense, the two pillars, then you should accept the truth. You know what I'm saying? Testify the truth, because you know what I'm saying, bro? As I mentioned, you're not guaranteed to live tomorrow. But on the point that if it's clear and it makes sense, that's what I always say. If it's clear, it makes sense, you believe it makes sense, it's the truth, then accept the truth. You know what I'm saying? accept it. You know what I'm saying? Those people, I mean, you're a big man, of course, but sometimes you're persecuting, you know, people or other than that. These people, you will not save me, and I will not save you. When you die, they will not save us. You know, that's why we have to make decision before it's too late. You know, that's why this life is like a bridge. No one build a house upon a bridge, correct? Why? Because a bridge, we utilize the bridge to cross from one side to the other side. So this life is like a bridge. We have to utilize it to cross to the next life. And we need something from this life for the next life. You know what I'm saying? So this life, God gave us what? Chance to think. In our time, if we speak about death in our society, they think, you're crazy. But nothing is guaranteed except death. You know what I'm saying, bro? How many of us, we have been neglectful toward our Creator? Not being grateful to Him. And if it's a time, it's a time to be grateful to your Creator. The two testimony, which is clear, you accept, I should worship my Creator and be grateful to Him. Prophet Muhammad, let me ask you, do you accept Prophet Muhammad to be a prophet? Based upon the information that you received about the prophecies, the miracle?
I hear all of that.
Yeah.
But that's all I know.
Okay. So you want to investigate more?
Of course.
No problem. Yeah. If you have any questions, you have more questions?
At the moment, no.
No other wives, brother. No wives, brother.
You're going to cause trouble, brother.
Yeah, that's the important one first, isn't it?
Let me give you this one. Yeah? Okay. Let me. She was asking questions. She mentioned about slavery in Islam. Okay? I have no problem with it. First of all, we don't have slavery in Islam. This term, we don't use it. Okay? Slavery, this term, we don't use it at all. In Islam, there's something called al-riqqa. What is al-riqqa? The word that I choose for it, me personally. Because why? When you use slavery, because what happened to the Africans, you know what I'm saying? People should always think, slavery, cutting off their testicles, oppressing people. No, in Islam, Prophet Muhammad said, Allah is the opponent of anyone that goes around and enslave people. Allah is his opponent. Another narration, Prophet Muhammad said, anyone that goes around and enslave people, his prayer will not be accepted. If the European accepted Islam, they would have gone to Africa. Even I know some Muslims did it as well. Some Arabs did it afterwards. But they were not following Islam. That's why I'm here to defend Islam. I'm not here to defend Algerian or Moroccans or Pakistanis. No, I'm here to defend Islam. Of course, if someone lying against Algerians or Pakistanis, I defend anyone who's been oppressed. But Islam. So some Arab doing crazy stuff doesn't mean Islam teaches that. So Islam teaches us that don't go around. However, in Islam, there's something in a war. In a war, back in those days, in a war, Allah gave to the Muslim leader four options. When you have war prisoners, either you take your freedom, he said, "Billah for Allah's sake, your freedom." Okay, Prophet Muhammad did that when he had a war with one village. He freed the people. Okay, another one, you exchange them with the other prisoners, like you know that your opponent took prisoners from your side. So you say, you know what? I give you the prisoners, your one, and give my one, okay? Third one, ask for money. I'm gonna give you the prisoners back, but give us money. Fourth one, you keep them to serve you. Now, when you keep them to serve you, there is specific system here. What is system? You treat them the way you treat yourself. And you clothe them, the same cloth you clothe yourself, you clothe them, okay? And you should not, if you give them a job to do, and if it's hard for them, you should help them. You see? So Islam doesn't teach us to go Africa or any country enslave people. Islam never came with slavery. You understand? Rather, the slavery that was practiced against the black people in Africa, Islam came and guessed it. You see what I'm saying? Clearly and guessed it. You know what I'm saying? So this woman, because in the Bible, yes. In the Bible, if you're not Israelite, you'll be enslaved. That's in the Bible, not in the Quran. No. That's why there is no verse in the Quran. Authentic hadith, it tells us to go enslave people. You know, rather also, not if you keep them as a servant to serve you, what you have to do is well. Allah gave many channels, many ways to free them. Imagine now I said, okay, wallah al-adim, I'm going to visit you tomorrow in Birmingham. Then I don't come. What I have to do, fast 3 days, okay, because I swore by Allah, okay. Or I free a servant. And Allah mentioned, Prophet Muhammad mentioned, one of the ways that lead you to paradise, to free the servants. So how can you compare that to the transatlantic slavery? Rather, it is known before that, you know, as I mentioned, there was many practices. The Africans had servitude of them. Because why? It was a war. People were having a war. They were like, you know, people bringing their family, everyone, in a different country. So her husband got killed. The people ran away. What are you going to do with these people? So they take them. We're going to take care of you, serve you, serve us everything, but with the law. And she was speaking, what was she saying about?
She's gone.
Is she or he? I don't know. It's a woman. I don't know.
Hard to tell,
hard one. Anyway, like even our time, you know. I mean, Islam. Look, in Islam, even this Islam gives you a clear guideline. Allah creates a man and a woman. You know, because in order for us to procreate, you need a man and a woman. You know, I mean, but you know, when the people start following their desires, Allah mentioned that in the Quran. When the people follow their desires, then the earth will be corrupted. And we can see that now. Now you don't know who you're speaking to. If he's a man or a woman. Sometimes he's a man, you call him sir, we don't call me sir. I'm offended. You call me,
you
call me.
Agenda.
Yeah, you assume yeah. Agenda. Someone said, what do you know, human being? I'm elephant, call me elephant. That's, you know, when the people turn away from the revelation of God, then they will be drowning in their darkness and evil, without any doubt. You know what I'm saying, brother?
So for instance, I mean, you're hitting on about gender and so forth. So someone who's gay, for instance, and let's say they say that they believe in God and so forth. What's your take on that?
In Islam, we believe gay doesn't take out for Islam. It's a sin, one of the major sins in Islam, yeah? But doesn't take out for Islam. So a person is gay and a Muslim, you cannot say because you're gay, you're not Muslim, you know? Because what I take out for Islam, if you believe, yes, gay is permissible. Because clearly you're going and guess God's teaching. But if you say, you know, I believe it's not permissible, I'm just following my desires, then you are a sinner in Islam, you know? Yeah, you are a sinner. That's why, you know, when I speak to even non-Muslim gay, I don't focus about is gay, I always focus about God, you know? I said, look, firstly, let us establish there is God, and if there is God, we have to know the one who knows about his creation is God, you know? So God created men and women and explained to them, then they understand. Because now societies are, and which society is a liberal, secularist, a society are determined to us how we should live our life. Like now, when you're a child, I have children, okay? You have children as well. Sometimes maybe your son, age of 3, says, I'm a dog. So you say, no, you're a dog. Oh, he's a dog. I'm going to take him. Maybe he's a dog. No, you know he's playing. You're not going to tell him, let me take him to hospital, give him some shots. Because maybe he's a dog. You say, no, he's playing. You know, but now, if he says he's a dog, you have to maybe accept he's a dog. You have to take him to hospital.
That lady earlier said there was some parents, their child started playing with the girl's toys, and because they couldn't get the operation for the child here, they took him to Thailand, and they gave him the operation.
Child?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true.
In Canada, they give you hormone suppressants. I think as many as 4 years old or something. Crazy.
Yeah, so and that's what Allah mentioned the Quran. You know, Allah mentioned the Quran that Satan said, I will inspire them to change Allah's creation. Allah mentioned in the Quran that Satan will inspire people to change Allah's creation. Like, you know, you look like a man, you go, somebody goes, you know. And it's one of the sins. This, according to Islam, according to Christianity, according to Judaism, is a sin. You know? But of course, we don't go, you see gay, you go harm him or something. But we, as a Muslim, I believe it's a sin, and I believe it's wrong. And the way I explain them, with the logical argument, with the proofs, even scientifically proofs. Like, even someone born gay. So when the baby was born, say, hello, you have a baby, it's gay. The doctor doesn't say that to you, is he? He's going to say you have a boy or a girl. By the time we live in, Prophet Muhammad prophesied about this time. He said there will be a lot of trials and tribulations. The trials and tribulations will be attacking the believer's heart. It's like a cloud. You know when it's a cloudy? One after one. One after one. And it's what's happening now. You know, all of that what we see now, Prophet Muhammad spoke about it. Clearly. Prophet Muhammad says it's going to come a time when a man will be like a woman. And it's going to come a time when a liar will be held as a truthful person. And the truthful person will be held as a liar. That's what's happening now. When Tony Blair and Bush went to Iraq, based upon a clear-cut lies, and they killed how many people? Million of people. And what this person said is a mistake. Simple, it's just a mistake, sorry. Sorry, we killed million people. They return Iraq back 200 years. You know? They said why? They said what? Because Saddam he has a chemical, biological, destructive weapon. None of that is true. What happened to Blair and Paul? And what was his name? Bush walking around free. You know? And they hold him as a truthful people. And now the people that are calling people to worship God and follow God say these people are a madman. Are liars. Look at this person. They say, I'm a liar. Why am I a liar? Prove to me, but to shouting. Because these people, they've been heavily influenced by liberal, you know? And that's why they say Islam about women, about this. They make it seem as women in our countries, we have a cage for them. We have a cage and a key. Come, my wife, go to inside the cage. Yeah, hello, come out. That's how they make it seem. You know how they treat? You can't go. Also about why you cut off the hands. Yeah, cut off the hands. Make it seem our countries, everyone working with two hands, without two hands.
Yeah, one hand.
Go, man, I go Algeria, go Saudi, people are war, women drive, women, you know what I'm saying? Now, all of that is just a lie, because why? Because they know Islam is the truth, so we have to lie against Islam and put many barriers to prevent the people from accepting the truth. However, there's people like you and other than you that are smart, who think, no, let me step back and read and study and think. Let me come to a conclusion by my own self, understand? I'm not going to listen to the media. Media are known to be liars. Look, just COVID-19, they drive us crazy, Ari. 50,000 died, 20,000, you know what I'm saying, bro? Yeah. Sorry for taking your time, brother.
No.
Thank you very much, man.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I bless you. I mean, I'm very grateful to you that you give me your time. I really appreciate it, man. No one knows how all this man. Now, bro, I'll give you some spiritual teaching. Give me some physical teaching, brother. How to keep this. I need to make sure I'm healthy. What do you eat, my brother? You have to teach us. You and him, mashallah. Mashallah, Allah Mubarak. It's good to look after yourself. And that's the teaching of Islam. Look after yourself. That's why Islam, when we say worship God, doesn't mean stay inside the mosque 24 hours. No. Looking after yourself, worship. Looking after your mother, it's worship God. You are worshiping God by looking after your family. Looking after the environment is worship. Defending the oppressed one is worship. Stopping the oppressor is worship. All of that comes under worship in Islam. So Islam worship is a universal term, meaning that whatever you do to please your creator comes under worship. Not because I stay in the mosque 24 hours. That's not from Islam. That's why one of the Muslim Prophet Muhammad disciple, he saw a man inside the mosque 24/7. He said, what do you do? He said, do nothing. He said, get out of here, go do something. He said, no, go do something, you know? That's why it's good to go gym. I tell brothers, go gym, you know, take care of yourself. You know, some people, as I've said, 19 years old, he looks like 55 years old. Too much burger, brother. You have to go to gym, man, brother. You have to care of yourself. And that's a teaching of Islam, you know. Teaching, like, look after yourself. Even Prophet Muhammad, when he said, eat third for your, what is it again? The
what suffices?
No, third.
Third air, third water.
Yeah, the third for air, third for water, and third for food. Ask all of it for food. Even water has no space. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, man. How are we not going back to Birmingham? We love it.
Whenever we're ready, man.
You know where to go? We'll go eat something together after.
We ate before we came.
Yeah, sure.
We ate just before we came back. We came a lot earlier.
Okay. But you're not thinking to leave now? Or you?
No, we'll go.
Yeah, maybe after. Maybe after we'll go. Maybe go for tea or something.
Yeah,
where is your cars? Is it parked somewhere?
That's part of North London.
Ah.
Yeah, just I'm not paying no congestion.
It's free, brother, Sunday. Clearly not from London.
No. Today. They've changed it.
Don't say that. He's finished.